Today, thank you, Mary. Today's training will be co-trained by two of us here with NOAA's Office for Coastal Management. So my name is Melis Ochter, and I sit in our Oakland office, and I am the Coastal Resilience Specialist. And I'm going to pass it to Lauren to introduce herself.
Hi everyone, thanks so much for having me. I'm Lauren Long and I work for NOAA's Office for Coastal Management with Melis. I'm our Pacific Learning Services Coordinator, so I have a few different roles. I spend part of my time delivering nature-based solutions training and developing learning resources around the topic. And then I also support our partners in the Pacific Islands and Territories on their learning needs and connecting them with OCM's resources. So thanks so much.
Thank you, Lauren. And then I'm going to pass it to a hopefully familiar face to some of you all, Sarah Vandershelly, who also works with NOAA's Office for Coastal Management out in Oakland, to give an.
Great, thanks, Melis. Good afternoon, everybody. I'm Sarah Vandershalley. I'm the Regional Coastal Management Specialist out here on the West Coast, and I'm also the liaison to the California Coastal Management Program, which includes many of you. It's just great to see so many familiar faces and names as I'm looking at the participant list and to see many new ones. One of my roles right now this morning or this afternoon is to welcome you on behalf of the team that put this together, and to provide you with a little background on how the training came to be. So I'm going to start with just a little bit of background. So this training is an outcome from a larger collaboration project that is focused on supporting coastal agency training needs. And it's between NOAA's Office for Coastal Management, the three agencies that implement the California Coastal Management Program, which most of you are part of, and that includes the California Coastal Commission, the State Coastal Conservancy, and the San Francisco Bay Conservation and Development Commission, as well as the three California National Estuarine Research Reserves. So, in case you're not familiar with the reserves in California, from north to south, that includes the San Francisco Bay Reserve, the Elkhorn Slough Reserve, and the Tijuana River Reserve. So all of the organizations that I just mentioned were connected through, and we partner in implementing the Federal Coastal Zone Management Act, which provides the framework for both the National Coastal Zone Management Program and the National Estuarine Reserve, excuse me, National Estuarine Research Reserve System. We all have a rich history of partnering across our different organizations in different ways in California. And so one of the unique things that's special about this collaboration project is that it does bring all seven of our organizations together. So we have a project team. Many of the reps from that team are on this call from each of the seven agencies. And we are working together to identify your coastal agency's training needs and then to take advantage of NOAA and the reserve training expertise to address them. So last year, many of you might remember responding to a survey regarding your individual training needs. Thank you for doing that. It was really informative to the team. And in looking at those results, we identified that nature-based solutions related to coastal hazards was a common topic across all three agencies. So the team is really excited for the training today, and we'll also be listening. We're thinking about how to identify future opportunities that we can create to help staff build off of what you learned today during the training. We have a great opportunity where we can leverage the reserves, coastal training, and technical assistance expertise and NOAA's resources to provide space for coastal agency staff, for all of you to learn from each other and to dig deeper into this topic. So stay tuned. There might be more to come after this training around this. I want to close just by, on behalf of the planning team, I'd like to thank you all for participating today and also extend a special thank you to our panelists, whom Lauren and Melis are going to introduce shortly. Thank you for taking the time to prepare for today, as well as just for sharing all of your expertise with us. I'm going to hand the mic back over to our trainers. So thank you very much.
I'm going to get started with sort of the core portion of our training right now. We're going to be exploring today how green infrastructure or nature-based solutions can reduce the impacts from coastal hazards like flooding and erosion, and find ways to overcome some of these common implementation challenges. So we're going to start off by sharing some broad definitions of nature-based solutions or green infrastructure in a moment. But I also wanted to mention that the specific intention of today, as Sarah mentioned, was really to hone in on shoreline practices in California for high wave energy environments. So that was identified as a big need and a big gap in understanding. Later, you're also going to hear both Lauren and I, and probably some of our speakers, using several different terms when we're describing nature-based solutions and green infrastructure. And we tend to use these quite interchangeably. Don't get too caught up on that terminology and which one to use, but really when you're speaking with folks or at your agencies, remember to use the term that resonates best with you, your audience, or your agency specifically. So the agenda for today, in just a moment, I'm going to debrief our part one, the basics, which hopefully all of you did before coming today online. And we'll be discussing that worksheet that was involved in the part one and what everyone's hazards of concerns were, the ecosystem services and the green infrastructure practices that you identified while doing that. So you might want to have that worksheet handy if you did it. And then Lauren is going to briefly mention some keys to successful implementation of green infrastructure. And these are things that our office has learned over the years in working and talking with experts. Keep your ears out for our speakers hitting on some of these keys to success. I think a lot of them will probably highlight some of the same things that we've been noticing. And then we're going to hear from some really incredible experts. First, we'll have Dr. Shaw Mead with eCoastal Marine Consulting and Researching. And then we're going to hear from George Kaminsky with Washington State Department of Ecology. They're both going to be sharing information on nature-based solutions that they have been implementing in these high wave energy shorelines. After their talks, we're going to move into a panel discussion where we'll be diving into these challenges and solutions and hear about any other tips they may have. So in this part, you'll have the opportunity to pose your questions through the chat. Please don't be shy about your questions. That's why we have these incredible speakers here with us today. And then in order to help us think about how these projects could really apply in our California coast, we're going to have Jeremy Smith with the Coastal Commission and Megan Cooper with the Coastal Conservancy also join us in that panel discussion. And then at the very end, to wrap, I'll be passing it back to Lauren, where she's going to be sharing some helpful resources and future learning opportunities that you all may want to be involved in. Okay, so part one. If you would, please, in the chat, share something that you learned or found interesting while you were doing in your part one virtual module before you came today. The variety of nature-based solutions. Yeah, thank you, Julia. That's definitely something that's really interesting, right? And not all of them are always what you are going to think about using in your location, or there may be ones that you never considered in your location. The importance of collecting and monitoring data before and after a project. Oh, Dan, the nature-based solutions literature database. That's great. Sorry, my chats keep moving around. Oh, that Great Lakes also have rise and fall of water levels. Yeah. That's why they're one of our coastal states. Helpful graphics, flexibility of terminology based on audiences, variability of scales. Great, thank you. Keep putting these in. And it's nice to see you all interacting with one another's comments too. Okay, I'm gonna keep us moving. All right, so just a quick reminder here that when we define green or natural infrastructure, we're talking about the existing natural environment as well as the engineered solutions that we're using that use nature to mimic these processes. So as mentioned in part one, these practices can range from landscape and watershed conservation and restoration to that community site, to the even smaller, specific site, like your backyard, bioswale, your really, really site-specific things. So today As requested, we're going to be focusing on these practices along the high energy shorelines, but of course, we welcome your thoughts and ideas on these other practices throughout the day. So as you learned in part one, we have this approach when we're thinking about our nature-based solutions and green infrastructure for hazard resilience. And we first think about how to mitigate these coastal hazards by using ecosystem services through implementing green infrastructure practices. So what we did in part one is we had you think through all these three pieces. And you probably saw this example or a similar one where you have a hazard as coastal flooding. And to mitigate that hazard, we need some sort of coastal flood control. And so one way to get that coastal flood control is by conserving salt marshes and creating community parks. But as many of you noted, there's many ways to provide this same service. So it's really critical that you understand the ecosystem service or the benefit that you are looking for from nature to mitigate your hazard. And that way you can pick your appropriate green infrastructure practice for your location. So it's really important to think about your location that you're working in and which practices will provide you the services that you need in your location. So ecosystem services was, you know, a big part of part one. And you probably noticed that another word for ecosystem services that we use is benefits. One of the greatest things here is that nature is providing us with so many benefits like erosion control, coastal buffering, and all of these things can help lessen the coastal hazard impacts that we may feel. So it's crucial to understand the coastal hazard and the ecosystem services that you need from nature in order to mitigate the hazard. The conditions at the location are also going to help you determine which practices can best provide the services that you need. So in this section, part one, you explored the ecosystem services that are key to selecting your green infrastructure practice. So again, you know, you have your goal to reduce coastal hazards, and you're looking at ecosystem services that are things like flood control, wave attenuation, and erosion control. But we're also starting to consider our co-benefits. And these probably started percolating for you naturally when you were thinking about it. What are some additional benefits that I could get by implementing some of these green infrastructure practices? So these are really oftentimes important to the community that you're working with. And they can be things like recreation, water quality, habitat, or even aesthetics. And you'll want to make sure that you're really considering your co-benefits when you're selecting your green infrastructure practice. And that's going to really create community buy-in as well. So the key takeaway from this portion is really knowing the ecosystem services that are most important to your community upfront is going to make your green infrastructure practice most successful. So the quick refresher from part one is that there's, you know, a variety of practices that you can implement to help achieve your goals and provide the ecosystem services that you identified. And practices can be across various scales. We have the landscape or watershed scale, which is the biggest scale. Then we have the community scale, which is kind of that medium scale, or we have a site-specific scale. So these practices, because of the different scales, can be quite vast in the different types of practices, right? They can include land conservation and urban forestry. They can be green streets or bioswales and rain gardens, or oyster restoration, wetland conservation, or of course, living or hybrid shorelines. So this was the worksheet that you worked through in part one, and you may have an example that looks similar or very different from the one that I have up here. Let's discuss the types of hazards and locations where you all wanted to work through this project. So in the chat, if you could share your coastal hazard of concern, the location, and the ecosystem service that reduced the impact, and then lastly, the green infrastructure practice that provided the service. So like, if I was going to put my response in the chat, my coastal hazard is coastal flooding in San Diego, California. My ecosystem service is wave attenuation, and I'm doing that through wetland restoration. Okay, great. We see an example here in Southern Eureka, from Joelle, thank you. Stormwater retention, sediment transport, and infiltration, thank you. Great, and the green infrastructure practice for the Eureka example was wetland restoration and managed retreat through land acquisition. Thank you. Some dune restoration projects to minimize shoreline erosion in Los Angeles. We have Ocean Beach in San Francisco through doing some flood control through beach nourishment. Oh, Point Isabel. Yes, I love going there with my dog. Thank you, Marilyn. Highway 37, definitely a big flooding area. These are great examples. Thank you. So we're seeing some similarities and some differences, right, in the different types of green infrastructure practices that folks are identifying as important for their hazards. So that really shows that some of these projects are at different scales. Some of these projects have different co-benefits and benefits that they're identifying. These are really good examples. Thank you all. Okay. And now I think I'm going to pass it to Lauren to do our keys to success. Thanks, Lauren.
Thanks, Maylis. So thank you all for sharing your ideas and thoughts in the chat. And hopefully when we get to our speakers, you'll be hearing more about some tips to kind of overcome some of the challenges you all mentioned. I'm going to briefly mention some keys to successful implementation before we dive into our speaker presentations. And Maylis talked about some of the ecosystem services or benefits from nature provided by green infrastructure at those multiple scales. You know, thinking about hazard reduction benefits, but also those co-benefits that are really important to communities. But we all know that while these solutions are really great, there's a lot of challenges for implementing these solutions as well. And so these are some challenges that we hear frequently. So, you know, we hear challenges for, you know, around understanding the effectiveness of these different projects and actually reducing coastal hazard risk. Also thinking about kind of their costs and benefits compared to your traditional infrastructure. We hear challenges around maintenance and making sure that these projects are maintained for the long term. Also, of course, you know, we have regulations in place that sometimes can be an incentive to implementing green infrastructure, but sometimes it can be a barrier. So kind of thinking about those ordinances and regulations and how can we change those so they can be create incentives for green infrastructure. And many times they're just older regulations. It's not that they intended to be a barrier, but those are some things that we hear from folks as they think about challenges and thinking about implementation. Of course, buy-in is a huge piece, getting community buy-in and helping folks kind of understand these new concepts and not be worried about doing something new versus something traditional. So we hear a lot of these different challenges. So, but today, hopefully we will be thinking about these challenges and really thinking about solutions. And again, like Maylis said, we're gonna be really honing in on California, thinking about these solutions in California's high wave energy environment specifically, to kind of help dive into the challenges and solutions there. So in a moment, I'm going to be turning over to our experts, Dr. Shaw Mead and George Kaminsky, who are going to be talking about projects that they have implemented along high wave energy shorelines and some of their challenges and some of their lessons learned and some of the keys to success that they have had. But we do know that in order to be successful in your projects, your designs should really consider the local landscape and be grounded in science and engineering. Your project should really align with community plans and goals. So green infrastructure should really be a strategy that comes out of a community planning effort that identifies goals that green infrastructure could help achieve. Your project should be cost-effective and well-maintained. You should engage your community members throughout the planning phase. So getting them involved early on can really help ensure success and ensure that their values are incorporated and that those projects really reflect what the community needs all around. And then you should also build partnerships over kind of a long term so you can leverage each other's expertise along the way, whether it's on a specific project you're working on now or one that you hope to work on in the future. It's good to have those partnerships in place. So be listening for these tips as you hear from Shaw and George. And then we'll be diving into a panel discussion where we'll talk even more about some of these tips to success and give you all some other things to think about. So during part one, Maylis shared the front page of this worksheet, but there was also a back page where you were able to kind of think about some of your own barriers and challenges and also opportunities. So this would be a good spot to take notes if you have this worksheet with you. As you're hearing from our experts and thinking about kind of how their work applies to the work that you all are doing. So before I introduce our speakers, just wanted to see if anyone had questions so far on what we've presented, and you are welcome to put those in the chat. So I'll just wait a moment and see if you have anything that we can answer before we jump in. All right. And feel free to enter any questions. Maylis and I will be monitoring the chat so we can answer your questions too as we go. So now we're going to be hearing from our amazing experts, Dr. Shaw Mead with Ecos Marine Consulting and Research, and with George and from George Kaminsky with Washington State Department of Ecology. Again, they're both going to be sharing information on shoreline projects they have implemented along high wave energy shorelines. Feel free to type questions for them in the chat while they're presenting. But we will stop after each speaker and briefly answer some clarifying questions, but we're actually going to save the majority of the questions for the panel discussion when we have Jeremy and Megan also joining us. But again, feel free to add questions, and Shaw and George, feel free to answer questions in the chat too while each other are speaking. So Shaw, you can go ahead and share your presentation while I introduce you.
Okay.
So Dr. Shaw Mead, we're super excited to have him. He is an environmental scientist and managing director at eCoast, which is a marine consulting and research organization focused on applying knowledge on physical and biological processes in a holistic approach to coastal, estuarine, and freshwater management. Dr. Mead has over 30 years experience in marine research and consulting and has helped produce over 700 technical reports pertaining to coastal management and hazards, coastal structures, erosion control, beach remediation and management strategies, surf break protection and management, marina and beach design, marine and freshwater and terrestrial ecology, coastal oceanography, and aquaculture. So I'm excited to actually see some of those technical reports, Shaw, and share those with our partners as well. So thank you so much for joining us. And I'll just pop in once we get like near the 15-20 minute mark. I'll turn my camera on to let you know. So thank you so much. I'll turn it over to you.
Okay. Good afternoon, everybody. It's only 10:30 in the morning here in New Zealand, here in England. But just a few things I'm just going to say to begin with. My slideshow is going to be a little clunky because it is old. It's been... in the introduction, it's probably been 3 decades working in this area before it was even called engineering with nature. And I guess what I'm going to present does cover all 6 of those topics in the welcome poll. And we are talking about wave attenuation on the exposed coast. So out there in the open. So engineering nature working on multi-purpose reefs. And then the last thing I'll just point out, that title slide, understand, innovate, and sustain. And it did come up in the presentation to begin with, the introduction, about understanding, this is our approach to any kind of coastal issue, but understanding and quantifying the environment that you're actually working within. Then looking at it and what kind of solutions you can use, and looking at innovation, being up to date with your work so that you can develop sustainable solutions. So just a quick overview of ourselves, and this is where I am right now, and I'm actually sitting in this office here so I can look out my window and see what the surf's doing. This is Raglan in New Zealand. We cover a whole lot of different areas of expertise, but of course, you know, mostly marine, but we also estuarine and freshwater. Work all over the world, and really, this is, I cut and paste this, but a lot of our work is in the tropical areas. We do a lot of work in Pacific Islands, working in Mauritius, the Maldives, British Virgin Islands, so those kind of areas, as well as the temperate sites. And they're quite different, but they actually do lend themselves very well to multi-purpose reef type technology. Myself, I try and specialize and stay down this end of the world these days and try not to travel too much. Okay, just an overview, just looking at the concept of MPRs, the design tools. I think they're really important, and showing the kind of research and application that's come from that research that's behind it. A few examples and some future directions. A lot of our work these days is, you know, we see this, you've all seen this, I guess this is the simple kind of response to climate change and sea level rise, where we look at the main three kind of aspects: the retreat, accommodation, and protect. That's been expanded to many more options these days, but they still fall in those main categories. We work a lot in the managed advanced buying time, and that is leaving things as they are, but trying to buy time in a natural way, working with the environments there. And for instance, in the Pacific Islands, quite a few places, we're looking at the 30 to 50 year planning horizon. It's very hard to, you know, to retreat sounds easy, but to move whole villages, whole communities, takes a lot of time and planning. So we're trying to buy time, even though we know that sea level is going to go on for not just the next 100 years, it's going to keep going. So retreat is inevitable in many places. I said nearly three decades, the basis of the MPR kind of work really came out of the Artificial Reefs Program back in the Center of Excellence at NIWA, which is our National Institute of Water and Atmospheric Research, similar to NOAA in the US there, and Waikato University. And I was looking at enhancing coastal constructions by incorporation of multiple use options, surf and dive and recreational and commercial fishing, navigation and safe swimming. And that again comes with the introduction of those co-benefits, those multiple use options. They're more and more important these days. And, you know, just to simplify what we're looking at, a lot of traditional coastal protection really is protecting the land. It's not working with all within the coastal system. It's not worried about the beach system. It's looking at the infrastructure and the land behind it. And if you do that, it's a band-aid approach and you're not addressing the cause, that usually fails. So what we're looking at is how does it work in nature, technology inspired by nature. So extreme case, we've got a kilometer wide reef, knocks out all the wave energy well offshore and attenuates it all. By picking up your coastal protection and putting it offshore and underwater, that's when you can add all those multi-purposes, beach amenities, surfing, diving, swimming, windsurfing, fishing. Very, again, old stuff, but very hard to address hot spot erosion with traditional kind of measures. You put in a grinder to stop the sediment transport, you just push it down the coast if you've got a longshore sediment transport. So looking at trying to understand how systems work and work within them. I said it was a solution inspired by nature. So the submerged structures, and here in our main picture, this is just north of Sydney, nice offshore reef at a place called Forrester. You widen the beach without those negative impacts that you get with hard forms of coastal protection on the beach. Sand can still move backwards and forwards between it. You've modified the wave environment by attenuation and by wave rotation. And once you actually do that and you design that man-made, you can incorporate all those multiple use or co-benefits, I think the word was used. So coast protection, but you improve that amenity, wider beaches, surfing amenity, ecological enhancement. So there's a couple of ways they work. This one on the left is in Japan, where they've used submerged structures before for quite a while, several decades now. This one is one of the first ones in the world. The one on the right is Naranac in Australia, and we look at it in a bit more detail. And you can see the wider beach all the way back. This is due to nourishment as well, so it's a hybrid solution. But let's have a look quickly at how they work. So dissipation and rotation. Dissipating, knocking out the energy offshore, often called wave attenuation. So less energy to reach the coast. The one is rotation, and that's an interesting one where you put a structure oblique, and so the waves, you change the angle to make it more parallel to the beach and reduce those longshore sediment transports that take sand away. An important aspect of that, though, is that the dissipation and the rotation aren't what protects the coast. Those two aspects actually lead to that wider beach, and it's well known these days that it's the buffer of sand or the widened beach that develops that actually helps protect the beach during storm events. And it's the combined processes of that reduction and redirection, which are the dissipation and rotation, but also favorable current patterns and the water level set down at the beach. If you're breaking your waves on a structure offshore, that's where the setup is, and you get slightly lower water levels inshore. Another very old cartoon, but really kind of summarized it. So you're putting your structure offshore. Sea life is really, I always talk about it as an artifact. You greatly increase the available habitat, stable habitat and ecological niches by putting it in hard substrate and complex three-dimensional substrate rather than mobile sandy sea bottoms. Fishing, diving, aspects that are enhanced by that. And then the ability to incorporate surfing, and that what we're looking inside at the swimming, boating, or if it's coastal protection from erosion, harbors, marinas. It's nature inspired engineering. A lot of these examples are from East Coast Australia and East Coast New Zealand. But the important thing about that is that California, especially Southern California, is very similar in the wave exposure and the tidal level, which is very important. You know, these micro tides or tides that aren't over 2 to 3 meters in range are important. In this first one, we can see that the waves are coming in at an angle, they're getting broken, so you're dissipating. But on the other side of that structure, you can see that they've been bent and rotated, so they're more parallel to the coast. So that's the different aspects of the dissipation and the rotation. So just going, as I said, there are a lot of them are East Coast Australia. This one here is East Coast America. Here we have South Africa and St. Francis Bay. So there's lots of natural examples all over the place, and trying to explain them there, they're just a few steps beyond submerged or detached breakwaters. And we know that this bottom table here over the years, different formula based on the how far offshore they are, how wide they are along shore, work out how big your salient will be. Part of that artificial reef program was actually looking at shoreline response. So Colin Andrews digitized over 150 different shoreline response to the offshore structures, came up with this complex formula, which can be used to empirically predict what you're going to get in terms of a shoreline response. And then the important thing there, when we, again, bringing that back to California, this curve and the black ones are examples from around New Zealand and Australia. And several years back, it was to do a project, I think it was in Solana Beach, putting onto our graph some of the places around Southern California, and see that they fit right in there, in those natural structures that we see in California with the ones in New Zealand and Australia, which have been used as those design guidelines. So along with that empirical kind of methodology, we also have the numerical kind of prediction. So here we're looking at 2D beach, and I won't run it all because I know we don't have a lot of time, but now you can see that we're using that kind of more state-of-the-art and up-to-date technology And here we're running over a year, so I jump all the way up to there, and we see these this kind of we see how it forms anyway, and get a good idea of it. From that kind of work, we can do sensitivity testing. This was a master's student that worked on this study here, so verified again using a sediment transport morphological model. And even taking it through to an example that we have in Ventura. This was back in 2001. We started working on this project. Ventura oil piers, there were the oil piers up on the top left there. They were removed. It used to be quite a good surfing break and a lot of sand. But once they were removed, within a few years, the sand disappeared. As you can see today, that's access under the freeway there to this. It's actually a state park. That's what it was being looked at. And you see no sand today. So some of the work we looked at and the structures for there was sensitivity testing. And that was basically using the morphological model. On the right, we've done it before and after with no reefs to make sure the model isn't making big artifacts. But if we look at these different crest heights, so we have three crest heights, so that makes the volume of the structure a lot bigger. We can see that if we that's the volume of the retention there, but if we drop the crest of that structure by only half a meter, we're only losing about 900 cubes of beach material. And that's 33% saving on the reef cost. So all the tools are out there. Other ones looking at rotation and how that works. Circulation of cells. So we know now we really do want this four cell circulation pattern. Otherwise, we cause erosion with these structures. And some of you may recall the PEP reefs on the east coast of America. Too many too close to the shore, they caused erosion because of this. They weren't getting the right circulation patterns. So again, we can use the numerical models to make sure that we are causing beach accretion structures instead of erosion. This one here, just looking at all the different tools that have been developed and additional research to get us ideas. So this is a lot of this here that I'm showing is looking at incorporating surfing into the structures. And I can't recall why they've got the red X's by them, but here, starting off artificial reefs for multiple use. Way back in 69, Ricky Grigg, I think it was, in California, Hawaii. So all the way through to the 21st century. So now there's several of these structures in the water. Looking at determining so you can incorporate surfing design. Some of the work that I did, but both of these ones were looking at predicting the break-in intensities into design. Jumping through these, Walker, Kimo Walker in California and Hawaii developed some of the first classification of surfing breaks. That was updated to, here we're looking in Hawaii, you've got 25 feet waves. We're not often hitting that these days. So bringing that back to, in most of the places around the world, I should say, into 4 meters, so your 12, 13 foot range. All these different studies, and I won't dwell on them again. This is our backyard study. Again, here's our office. So studying these reefs over the last 30 years has been useful. The marine enhancement, as I said, it's just an artifact. You put something in there, stable and underwater, you know, greatly improve the local amenity. Biology. Other validation of design. So here we've got on the top, physical modeling versus how the Boscombe Reef broke. Validation of, we've got an aerial photograph or oblique photograph on the bottom left. The actual bathymetry survey in the middle, and then some modeling looking at how that salient would develop. And just getting towards the end now, just show the Gold Coast Reef in Australia. This is one of the earliest reefs back in 98. And again, looking at all those multiple uses and the cost benefits. For every dollar they predicted that you'd get $60 to $80 return, and future studies have shown the same. won't go into it, but as I said, understanding that environment, lots of studies went into there to create the best design for the site. You saw this figure before. Each one of these are sandfill containers, is about 20 meters long. Just last year, this one is continued maintenance. Just last year, further bags were put on. They've actually standard at 40 meters offshore and greatly enhanced the surfing amenity on it. But you can see what we're looking for. So there's wider dunes. These dunes have been planted, creating that salient. Interesting one, we have over 500 cubes net transport to the north, and that you still get a stable beach to the north, not that groin effect on the downward side. So again, that artifact, this is the artificial reef itself with marine life, the surf and amenity, and how much wider that the beach is now. And this is older, and I just saw updates at the ICCE in Sydney last year, how that's performing. And again, just after a storm in June, showing how it worked. It's a big tourist spot. So the monitoring, 10 years of monitoring from the top of the high-rise buildings there, you can see that the impact is tapering off some 2 kilometres all the way to the south. Another quick example in Kerala, India, a very important tourist spot. Looked at and put in a multi-purpose reef structure just offshore in this corner. Lots of erosion and threatening the areas there. Great area, lighthouse here. You can climb up there and take photos from the same spot. And just worked out that from daily camera work. So prior to putting it in the reef, the beach was way back here, and very good beach response. Then just to the last one now, the most recent multi-purpose reef went in just up the down the coast south of the Narrow Neck Reef. This was completed, finishing construction in early 2020, made of rock, geotextile containers, useful and fairly inexpensive, but need a lot of maintenance. Whereas your traditional engineering and more, we're going back to these and they're lasting a lot longer. It's retaining over 440 cubes of sand, increased surfing from 3 days to by more than 3 days a week. And that's a regular fishing and diving spot. This was a historically an erosion hotspot in the middle of Palm Beach here. Then just finally looking into some of the future work that's being looked at. Rather than putting them so close to the beach, looking at focusing structures. So you'll all be familiar with the focusing of the waves at Mavericks. Makes these very big waves, your largest on that part of the coast. We have similar things in New Zealand. This is down in Aramaina Spit. Did a lot of work how local dredging was impacting on it, but creating waves like that. But also, this is another spot in New Zealand. Waves get focused on these offshore reefs here called the Fowler Grounds, this reef system offshore, moving in closer. It's at the northern part of Poverty Bay, so it's on the east coast, so it's spun round. But the important part of looking at that, the Fowler Grounds, it's known for Midway Beach or the pipe making good surfing waves, but also it's created this natural salient and widened the beach by over 80 metres. Similar in Brazil, we have a site, you expect it behind that kind of structure, but also over a kilometre offshore, we've got this salient feature here that's up to 60 metres wide. It is also a surf break. So just to summarise, we're trying to look at hybrid solutions in Waihi, they posed a 1.1 kilometre seawall. Rather than doing that, putting in multi-purpose reefs, renourishment, and then the dune restoration. So the hybrid solutions, bringing in soft and hard engineering, but working in within those natural processes. Just a reminder how that this kind of technology is likely very good for the coastal, the Californian coast, and also the socioeconomic value of having the beaches. And you're probably all familiar with it. It's Houston. I think you're a guy from the U.S. Army Corps Unit of Engineers. done a lot of work on how valuable your beaches are. So finally, a thorough understanding of the coastal processes at each site and the function and impacts of different coastal protection options is needed in order to select that most appropriate option. And I think, again, while we're talking about these multi-purpose reef structures, is that they fit very well. Too often in the past, we look at costs. The lowest cost is best, effectiveness second, sustainability, and those co-benefits last, when I think they really all should be balanced and come into the solutions. And finally, I just bring that in. It is what we use in New Zealand in the Ministry for Environment to look at coastal plans, especially with sea level rise and climate change. And that really what I wanted to point out is that big buy-in by the community. The whole thing's driven by community engagement. Know what's happening, what matters most to the community, and then look at how we can do it before we start implementing our sustainable solutions. And so I've gone a little bit over time, but thank you, and I will get rid of my screen there.
Thank you so much, Shaw. Really appreciate the awesome information. And we have a few kind of comments in the chat. Kelly said the variety of shapes of the artificial reefs are really interesting and the modeling abilities out there. Mary Lynn asked what materials were used for the reefs that you presented and what was the source of the materials?
So initially, a lot of the reefs were made out of large geotextile containers. So some of the containers were massive, 60 meters long by 6 meter by 3 meters. Materials, PET material, so it's environmentally inert. That was one of the, I guess, a few reasons they were used. One was the perception that they could be easily removed. That hasn't really panned out. Another reason, they were considered safer than rocks in the surf zone. And one of the big reasons is that the carbon footprint for that kind of technology is tiny compared to quarrying rock, straightening it to your coast and putting it out there. It's tinier than any other form of coastal protection per cubic meter that you can actually create. But now in the last, since about 2010, was an evolutionary dead end going down the those containers. Maybe if you put concrete in them and stabilize them, they'd be all right, but the whole structures remain fluid. So since about 2009, the Borff Reef started using traditional construction. So usually using a core of smaller rock and then putting your armor stone over the top, like you might have seen if you noticed in that Palm Beach one, the one recently finished, and so the one in Albany, Australia, is about to be built, and that's similar construction.
Thanks, Shaw. And so there was kind of a couple of follow-up kind of questions. So it sounds like, there was a question about recommended materials to be used, like boulders from local rock outcroppings or granitic boulders. I think I hopefully pronounced that correctly. So I think you kind of were touching on that a little bit, how it's changed. And then there was also a question about like old shipping containers, which I'm assuming are different from the geotextile containers that you mentioned, but kind of like, what would be that
would be steel construction. There has been looking to the steel kind of construction, and even in India, floating reefs have been made out of steel and then floated offshore and sunk. In terms of the rock, compared to the rock that you need to put on the shore in your much steeper construction, because we're looking at much gentler slopes, your rock size can be dropped quite dramatically, which is if you're familiar with rock, the bigger your rock, the more expensive it is, not only to buy that rock, but actually to move it around, to place it and all the rest of it. So, yeah, but rock, we do keep going back to that traditional construction. We are looking in Japan. There are literally millions of unused tetrapods in Japan. They just line their coasts everywhere. using them in this kind of format. What do they call them? Tessellations, trying to fit them together. But yeah, it's mostly rock is being used these days.
What are your thoughts on the shipping containers, putting those offshore? Someone mentioned it was like putting garbage into the environment.
That is the problem. I mean, look, and actually steel in the sea, most of our oceans, especially down in the southern hemisphere, are iron deplete. There's even talk about it still. We've been talking about it for 40 years, about filling containers with iron filings and dumping them in the Southern Ocean as part of climate change strategies. So that'll enhance the growth of phytoplankton and krill and tide up. But so the containers themselves, but I just wonder when you get to that stage when they are falling apart, what do you do with them? They're not going to last forever. They are steel, so it is, and as I said, that has been talked about, and there is another example on East Coast India, massive, I think it's 50 by 70 meter steel construction that is being shaped like a big triangle as a reef for coastal protection.
Thanks, Shaw. And I see two more questions in the chat around sea level rise and conditions or factors making a location not suitable for an artificial reef. And I think we're going to hold those for the panel discussion and then invite you back on in a little bit, Shaw, and ask those questions then. So I think I will turn it over to George. Thank you so much, Shaw. We'll see you back here in just a moment. I'm going to introduce our next speaker, George Kaminsky, who is a senior coastal engineer with the Washington State Department of Ecology with 32 years of applied research experience in coastal engineering and geomorphology with expertise in coastal processes, morphology change, sediment budgets, and nature-based engineering designs. He plans, develops, conducts, and oversees independent studies related to coastal natural hazards, coastal erosion, natural resource management, and coastal engineering practices. So we're really grateful to have you today, George. And I will send it over to you. Thank you so much.
Great, thanks, Lauren. Appreciate the opportunity. Hi, everyone. I'm gonna talk about, focus on use of cobble berms. I like to call them backshore cobble berms on composite beaches. Another name that I'll use interchangeably is dynamic revetments. And I'm talking about these applications for high energy coast in the state of Washington. So I'm going to just do a quick overview of the use of these berms that we've been working on, explain some terminology, and then look at some applications and consideration of applications given the setting that they're going in. Just look at three case examples, sort of a minimalist Band-Aid approach, a sort of medium size community approach, and then a large project constructed by the Corps of Engineers. And then just conclude with some lessons learned. This is a very brief overview talk. I could probably spend at least an hour on any given one of these case examples, and then also talked about many other aspects that's more general in terms of nature-based approaches, but I just don't really have the time here, but feel free to bring these up in the discussion. So here's the coast of Washington, the areas that I've been focusing on for this talk. Calalock is a natural cobble berm that's backed by a bluff. Westport and North Cove and Shoalwater, these are sandy beaches, they're backed by dunes primarily. It's made up of Columbia River sand. We're in the Southwest Washington here, and Calalock gets up to about mid-coast of our Pacific Ocean coast of Washington. Entrance to Willapa Bay there at North Cove and Shoalwater, it is in the entrance, but this is an untamed natural inlet with high wave energy right at the mouth of Willapa Bay. And just to illustrate how energetic it is, this is an area back in the 1800s had a large spit, you can see in the red shoreline outline, and that was called Cape Shoalwater. And with all the erosion up to 37 meters per year over this past century or so, it became known as Washaway Beach. And now we're back to trying to call it North Cove. North Cove was a town that there's a very small fraction of it remaining with all this erosion. But I wanted to illustrate not just, in terms of this area being among the most intense wave climates in the world with high wave energy, but also a particular application here where we did the Band-Aid approach at North Cove and had a lot of success with it. This is the context of which these cobble berms as a nature-based approach have been applied. And then just to zoom in here a little bit on the recent history, going up to 2017, just wanted to put it in context. We've had an average of 18.7 meters a year of shoreline retreat in this time period just before we installed a cobble berm along this very stretch of coastline here, and had great success on a sort of annual scale, essentially completely stopping the erosion. And I'll just briefly be able to touch on this within this talk, but I just want to give you the context. So when someone says, well, nature-based approaches don't work on high energy environments, I would challenge them to think of a more erosive, higher energy case than North Cove, of which we've seen lots of success. Another view of this is at North Cove during a recent winter storm. And we have elevated water levels. And then on El Nino, strong El Ninos will give us accentuated waves from the south, typically, where we have erosion. And this sort of cartoon in the lower left there illustrates the exact scenario of which North Cove sits, where it's particularly exposed to the southerly waves coming up and hitting it abruptly straight on, and being a very erosive environment. And then in addition, what we see is typically some elevated water levels that can last for a few months. So it's sort of analogous to getting sea level rise in a very accelerated way, leading to what we call hotspot erosion on the southern end of the drift cells, littoral cells. So in the context of how we came about this, was really looking to our natural cobble berms that exist in the Pacific Northwest. This site here in Kalaaloq, as I showed, it's on our mid-coast. It's a natural formed cobble berm. Likely most of the cobbles came out of the eroding bluffs, probably centuries or even millennia ago, gradually accumulated. And this was sort of the inspiration for the application of dynamic revetments, because we noticed under really these high wave energy and high water level events, it's remarkably stable. That we don't see any more erosion of the bluff behind it. It's formed a natural crest. It accumulates a lot of logs along the top slope and crest. And it's just highly resilient to high energy events. And so basically taking this sort of cobble dynamic material and adapting it in places that don't have this material necessarily. In the case of Westport, which I'll show, that there is some gravel in the substrate that exists from a lower sea stand, but generally these are fine sand beaches that we're applying this and putting them in front of dune type backed uplands. But the idea is to use this approach to dissipate and absorb the wave energy and provide a more stable depositional backshore environment. It's a more resilient transition from a high energy beach to a dune environment that exists to also do the same type of thing, but it's more resilient given the larger material that's a little bit less mobile. So a long list of words here, but basically just to kind of set the tone of this, there's a lot of different functions that this kind of approach can serve, and based on what is desired for the project to achieve, it sort of scopes the design a bit and the considerations of how things are approached. But just to go through some key ones here, a lot of it is to do coastal protection, but there is a sort of a hold the line versus a managed retreat approach. If it's whether we're trying to really not lose any beach and stop the erosion in its tracks, or just slow it down and buy us more time, as Shaw was mentioning. In the case of North Cove, what we really found is we're just able to break the erosion cycle, which sometimes is sort of a self-feeding mechanism when a dune scarp is formed and it can't recover during quiescent periods, and it creates a reflective wave environment that scours and continues to sort of feed on itself. Applying a cobble berm can take the energy out of that reflection and create a more stable environment. It may not necessarily stop the erosion depending on the scale of the project, but it will certainly break the erosion cycle. And that's the example we see in North Cove, and even with a what you call a band-aid approach. Erosion is sort of front and center, but also flooding, the prevention of overtopping, and the cobble berms do absorb a lot of energy, and given the elevation considerations, they can certainly be built high to prevent overtopping initially, and also with enough material. Research has shown that it is a good approach for sea level rise consideration, that the material can actually move upslope and build a higher berm if there's enough volume and material to work with. And so it is amenable to protection of flooding, but you still need to have the horizontal space for the material to move if it's not installed at a height that's going to prevent that initially. There is more stability as waves and water level changes, and if beaches erode, the foreshore can still erode in front of the cobble in high energy events during the winter. And so how much can the structure accommodate that beach erosion is, again, a matter of design considerations and application for the intended purpose. Similarly, we can take really like a highly adaptive management approach where, like in the case of North Cove, we're sort of managing it year by year. If we take out the largest storms that typically occur in the winter, and we basically mitigate the massive erosion effect that they were having, that certainly is an adaptive management approach. And it's really a question of how big the structure is and what the function is desired. I don't want to go through each of these design criteria, but these are some things to think about. Just hit on a couple. The toe elevation is one that comes up. Typically, we've seen that we don't necessarily need to key in like a conventional structure and excavate down and install cobble materials, but just allow the structure to adjust over time. You just have to account for the change in volume as that happens, or the elevation, I should say, of the toe as the beach erosion happens during storm events. If, for example, a project is installed during summer months when the beach is higher. Naturally, whatever slope is installed, expect that's going to evolve. It's going to develop its own morphology and sort of an equilibrium slope that can also change seasonally, just like a beach does. Material size and gradation. We found that one thing is having lots of a well-graded material that has a lot of small sort of everything from coarse sand to pea gravel to pebbles on up. Is important for retaining the sand underneath. We'll talk about that a little bit. Angular versus rounded is something that's come up, and we found that angular material works quite well and also rounds naturally over time. And again, one of these things that I'm not going to get into too much here, but we've used a lot of large woody debris, which we have in the Northwest, introduced vegetation or dune grass. Sand is generally not a problem in terms of supply. It's not too much in deficit on our particular coast, but the use of hybrid structures, particularly use of large wood, kind of engineered wood structures, is also something we've been working on and successfully integrated. So I'm focusing on cobble berms, but these other materials are complementary in terms of the approach. So let's just get into the examples here. North Cove dynamic revetment. This is a bit of a cartoon, but a typical cross section that was drawn, and it was sort of intentionally developed as a sort of conceptual design in order to have some flexibility. There's a lot of variation along the shoreline in terms of the scarp face that we were existing. You see here in the cartoon anywhere from 2 to 15 feet in elevation, from top of Scarp to the toe along the shoreline. Pretty much the entire stretch of North Cove had an erosion scarp that, because of the long history, you know, over the past century, basically the scarp would form in the winter and could never recover. So we had this cycle of erosion going on. The there is not really much of a dune left. It was just basically eroding into the community. So between large trees and the community, there was no actually dune grass remaining at this shoreline. But the idea was to help introduce the grass to stabilize the back shore after the placement of cobble, and sort of this wedge-shaped configuration along an eroding scarp. So that's the project was built incrementally. Again, sort of the Band-Aid approach, using about the minimum amount of material. And this is just sort of three views of the same location of the shoreline over just about 2 years, and just to show you some the variation and the initial start point of having this winter scarp condition. And we placed these what we call Corey's balls, or angular material, right from or pit run right from the quarry along the shoreline in this wedge shaped configuration, and then also on the back shore put up a lot of large woody debris at the crest to build a protective berm, because there was not much elevation behind this. And again, this was just installed to the elevation of the land. There was not a design elevation. The money was limited. We had a 2 kilometer stretch of shoreline to treat. So it's just sort of let's install the material and see how it does. After some initial tests looked very promising at a very small and local scale. And it turns out that after the second summer, this image on the bottom, basically you could see all the sand. Say, well, what happened to the cobble? Well, the cobble is covered in sand. There's so much sand recruitment against the lower face of the revetment, you could barely see it. And it's only at the upper ends you see the accumulation of drift logs had come in, and very little of the cobbles generally can be seen during the summer months. And then the vegetation started coming in among the large wood and such on the back shore. So extremely successful and rapid recovery from a shoreline that had seen nothing but erosion for over a century. And this is an example. Take the key I got from Shaw in the earlier conversation about example of a managed advance. This is actually it wasn't portrayed. We could actually accomplish this, but on the west side there is subject to large fluctuation in sediment supply, and we were fortunate to get waves assisting in this process. But after stabilizing the back shore with the cobble dynamic revetment, we tried this. I should say we. It's my colleague who unfortunately passed away this past summer. David Cottrell is his genius mind that came up with it. But this idea of placing this cobble ridge, it's above mean high water on the sort of just seaward. It's 10, 20 meters in front of the dynamic revetment. And the idea was that as waves came up and gently came over this, it could deposit sand on the landward side. It could also accumulate sand on the seaward side. Logs would tend to wash over and accumulate in this area here. Windblown transport would also help to accumulate. And so what we found is that this was seriously, like literally an example of managed advance, where we went from this eroding scarp back here, you can see by this blue structure, and literally filled in this zone between this cobble ridge on the foreshore and the dynamic revetment on the back shore. And this is just the views over time, through by 2022 and through present. It's basically accumulating a dune ridge and dune field that's growing in elevation and density of dune grass, and it's stabilized really quite nicely. And again, this is an area that had so much retreat over so many decades into the community and into, basically trees and lawns. There was no dune grass at all along this shoreline. And now we have dunes actually growing in front of what the community only saw as erosion for over a century. So huge success there. So much so in that kind of approach that this is actually a contingency plan for this winter, because we actually have in this site, this example of managed advance, we also have managed retreat, where it's not all rosy everywhere. There's still a lot of erosion further to the east along this project. But this is actually the contingency plan that the Corps of Engineers has agreed to in the event of sort of an emergency situation. We have this plan to place material both as a lower foreshore berm and the back shore. Not a lot of material. You can see it's only 4 cubic yards per foot. That's a pretty small quantity in sort of commensurate with the Band-Aid approach that I mentioned. This is a really small scale project, but it's done wonders to really reduce the amount of erosion. But the idea here, again, is just as an illustration, is use the large wood, anchor the sort of large trunk of the tree into the cobble, the large root wads facing seaward. And we found that this is remarkably stable and successful in accumulating sand and even with this berm here on the foreshore, if it's completely obliterated, what we found is this really does nicely in feeding the dynamic revetment that's landward, dissipating energy as it does so. So really remarkable way to actually feed where you're actually doing the dissipation as it's feeding into the revetment. So in not all cases will this berm stay in place. If it's too energetic, it'll naturally move landward, but we found this is a really successful way of nourishing the revetment as opposed to putting it at the top. So now I'm going to switch over to Westport. I'm not going to spend the time, but if you go to this link, it's they have a webcam situated up here in this building, and it's really cool because you can just click on there. You go to the right of the screen, and it goes to a webcam, and it literally pans from the north end of this project all the way toward the south end. So it's a nice view of. Sorry, I'm getting a call here. It's a nice view of the dynamic revetment in its whole length of about 700 feet along the shoreline. This is an engineered dynamic revetment, and you can kind of see the cross-sectional drawing, and it's made of two types of materials, a pit run angular material in the center, and then it's capped with rounded material along the surface and the crest. This differs from the North Cove approach. At North Cove, we had no design elevation to the berm crest. We could just put out material as much as could be afforded with a small amount of money. This one has a 15-foot crest width. It's up to 20 foot in elevation. At best, 20 foot is high at North Cove. We typically more at the 16 foot level, which is too low. This is backed by a dune up at 26 foot, about 26 foot, 27 foot elevation behind it. This is a sort of a third or fourth generation approach. Previously it was a dune with woody material out in front, and there's plantings of dune grass, and they tried a bunch of different things, and then they resorted to the cobble berm as being much more durable and more resilient. So as I showed it, well, I didn't actually show, but at North Cove, I saw showing that the contingency plan is to add about a total of 4 cubic yards per foot. This is the design here is about 16 in total. North Cove is somewhere around the 8 to 10 cubic yards per foot in the cross section in terms of the volume. This is more of a medium scale approach. It's done quite well. It was installed in January 2022, or just in early January. And it, so it went through that part of the winter, and it's gone through this past winter, and it's done remarkably well on this open coastline in Washington. So these are just the project dimensions and quantities. Here's a little bit more in the details. I mentioned it has a dune cap and behind it to take up any overwash. Even with the events where we saw overwash and quite a bit of erosion at North Cove this past winter's around the December 27th storm, this cobble berm is quite resilient, and it didn't see any kind of overtopping at that 24 foot elevation of the crest, 25-foot elevation. Just a view of some of our profile data in compared to that constructed cross-section. We kind of just merged the two data sets, and remarkably stable. The lower part of the revetment has seen some erosion, but there's been some accretion on the upper part. I'll zoom into this plan view in a sec. But just to illustrate, this is the kind of response that we see when there's sufficient amount of material. Is generally we see upslope transport of cobble material. There's sometimes a bit of a sort of a lag deposit in field experiments and our observations, I should say lab experiments and our field observations. We see sometimes there's a bit of a trail of a very small amount of cobble seaward of the placed toe, but generally just a few percent, maybe 5-10% order of magnitude material gets shifted seaward, maybe in some of the downrush and the bigger energy events, but most of it stays right where it's placed. And generally the cobble likes to stay at the cobble and the sand stays at the sand, and they play nicely together, but they like to have their separate areas. And so we've seen this where you get the upslope transport where there's sufficient volume of material and that can be absorbed under energetic events. I'm going to show in the next couple slides just the differencing, and basically it's take one survey, a topographic survey, our second survey, and then difference them. We actually survey quarterly, but this is just to give you the quick overview of what we've seen so far. A nice break line around 20-foot elevation. There's some erosion, basically, again, some shifting of this material going upslope. And then there's also, I believe, some settling. There's some beach lowering. And there's that sort of natural accommodation of the toe. There was no excavation of the toe. It sort of just lowers as the beach lowers in front of it. Generally here, you can see in this table, about 8% of the material would need to be added if we want to maintain the same cross-section of the as-built design. And this community intends to top that up this fall to be just back to construction scale. But generally, I don't think this is really lost material. If there's some small amount of spreading to each side, actually causing accretion and as a bit of an end effect, not erosion, it's been remarkably stable. There's some areas that it sort of eroded enough, or the slope adjusted enough to get into the pit run material in the core. And here's just a photograph of that. And you know, that's not really a problem. I think mostly the rounded cobbles were installed from an aesthetic point of view. It is next to a state park and that sort of thing. But the as we've seen at North Cove, that angular material actually rounds pretty nicely in a few years under these high energy environments. Here's just a view of what typically looks like in the fall. You have before the winter events, you have accreted drifted sand, lots of log accumulation, some vegetation coming in. Looks like a quite healthy backshore compared to what we would see immediately to the north and south of this is just an erosion scarp that hardly recovers. Now onto a very massive scale project. This is an aerial shot where this is a place called Empire Spit. It's basically a spit, actually offshore a barrier island in front of the Tokelau Peninsula. And this spit protects the Shoalwater Bay Tribe. The Corps of Engineers has a responsibility to protect the tribe. And so this was the condition. It was just a narrow spit. There was a little bit of cobble placed out as an emergency measure, not enough to hold it. It broke through, and the Corps came back in last summer and installed this massive quantity. This was already a dune project. And they were able to put this cobble berm in front of it. And you see the size of this 75 foot in cross-sectional crest width, quite massive. You see the numbers here, 36 cubic yards per foot compared to 16 at Westport and somewhere on the order of 8 at North Cove. And then not only does it have a massive berm, but it has a massive dune behind it. So a huge restoration project. You can kind of see the scale. There's some equipment and here's a large trailer and some trucks. Here's a bulldozer, another truck. You see the size of this revetment is just massive. Just over this past winter, just to report on how it's doing. Done quite well, remarkably stable. Well, maybe not so remarkable. I think it's going to be stable for quite a long time. It's a very different scale of project. It absorbs a lot of energy. It's recruited some large wood. It's formed this nice ridge here. You can see in the photograph, and also in this cross-sectional diagram. Again, you have this sort of upslope transport. You have this, and we see this at Kalaloc too, where the face of the berm can get pretty steep up to where there forms a berm, and then it gets shallower slope toward the toe. And you see a little bit of this seaward transport where it shallows out, but it's generally a really small amount of material that goes seaward. The coarse material itself creates a sort of a depositional environment for windblown and marine transported sand. And we see much of this lower part of the berm covered in sand during the summer months. There's sand fencing on the backside of this that captures windblown sand coming over the dune. You can start, or you see quite a bit of accumulation on the backside with use of sand fencing. So, and here's just an aerial view of this restored dune and with the cobble berm in front of it. Just want to also point out North Cove is off here to your to the left in the north end of the sea green. And this area here is called Graveyard Spit. Actually, this coming next year, next summer, we expect to see another project there. It just got funded by a variety of sources, about another kind of a $25 million project, a little bit smaller scale than this project, but it's also kind of incorporating the same approach as this Empire Spit project at Shoalwater Bay. It's going to have a dune behind it and a revetment out in front of it. This is mainly spearheaded by our DOT and pretty innovative because they're way outside their traditional right-of-way. They're actually being really innovative and commended for that. They have the state highway runs right along the shoreline here. It's low-lying, and everyone's bought in and understands that with a low-lying highway along the shoreline, it's not a good approach to try to fight the battle there. Let's maintain a spit here, protecting a salt marsh area behind it, and creating a feasible way to keep the ocean at some distance from the road, because once it gets back in here, they have a lot of debris and can come over the road, and it creates quite hazardous conditions, and it's pretty untenable to fight the shoreline at the road edge. So that's going to be happening coming up here in the next couple of years. Just quickly to end up with some lessons learned. Again, I just feel like I'm just barely touching any of the science and the monitoring and engineering behind this, but just to get you some sort of take home messages. We've placed these cobble revetments on sandy beaches, and they provide a valuable coastal protection function. We found that they reduce the wave reflection, dune scarping, and toe scour, breaking the cycle of erosion and creating depositional conditions, not only for large wood and sand, but also allowing the vegetation to help to stabilize and recruit even more sand. The berm itself stays as a very fairly coherent structure. There's not a lot of loss of cobble, even the longshore in most cases, let alone the offshore. It really kind of retains itself. And again, with enough cross-sectional material, we've seen the material actually go upslope as well. Poorly sorted cobbles, as I mentioned, having a fine fraction of material is also really important. This is really highlighted at North Cove because the material was relatively thin. It really didn't have that cross-sectional volume to absorb, but we found that dissipation can happen really effectively within just about 12 to 18 inches of basically a surface lens of cobble. If it has enough fine material, can do a remarkably well in stabilizing and preventing erosion. If it has enough of a fine fraction to protect the sand underneath it, these berms do need to have a sufficient amount of material though to adapt under increasing waves and water levels. In North Cove example, there's just not enough cross-sectional volume. So when you have super elevated water levels that like we had on on top of king tides, and water levels were running 2 foot higher or so, it just wasn't able to build a volume crest, and there was overtopping and loss of material. We do see a lot of changes in elevation on the face of the structure, and moderate waves can do more harm than if it's just the large waves on a low water levels. Beach sand elevations across the lower berm can fluctuate rapidly, and the recovery under mild wave conditions can happen really quickly. The surface and subsurface cobble size and composition can fluctuate really locally. There's a lot of morphology in the berm itself. There can be significant accumulation of sand in the voids of the cobble, and that actually helps to build up the elevation of the lower slope. As I mentioned, the basalt rock becomes rounded really quickly with a few years. It's almost indistinguishable from the rounded material after about 4 years at North Cove. Sand, large woody material, beach rack, and vegetation are really complementary components in enhancing the overall resilience of the approach, and shoreline retreat is reduced using these complementary materials by quite a bit. Summer beach sand accretion generally covers much of the cobble slope. So in terms of a recreational effect, we've not seen any real negative effects. It creates a nice built up sandy beach environment when most people were out recreating on the shoreline in Washington. And one of the interesting things we've seen is that it's actually advantageous to nourish the cobble berms during times of accretion, because you can take advantage of that accumulated volume of sand. So that's the key messages. Lots of people to acknowledge, and thanks for your attention. Sorry if you can hear some dogs barking in the background. Someone's actually insisting they want to talk to me at the door. Apologize for that.
Thank you, George. Thanks so much for sharing your expertise. There are quite a few questions in the chat for you, but because we're a little short on time, I'm going to just move us to the panel. So if you don't mind, George, so you can either kind of try to answer some of those questions in the chat while we're doing the panel. You can also, at the end of the training today, I'll be sharing some resources. So when I'm doing that, you can also try to answer some of the questions, but you have a handful of those in the chat. But I'm going to move us to the panel. So I'm going to let welcome Melis back on camera and Dr. Shaw. And then George, you can stay on camera as well. And Melis, I'll let you introduce our other two panelists.
Thank you, Lauren. And Megan and Jeremy, if you don't mind turning your video on too while I introduce you two. So we have the pleasure of having two friendly faces joining us on our panel today. We have Megan Cooper, who's the South Coast Regional Manager for the Coastal Conservancy, and she makes funding decisions for many types of nature-based and coastal adaptation projects. So we're really excited to have her join the panel. And we also have Jeremy Smith, a coastal engineer with the California Coastal Commission, and he sits within the Technical Services Unit and supports permitting and planning staff statewide. So I think you both are going to really help us hone this to the California level. So thanks again for joining. I'm going to start with the two of you. How do you see the projects that George and Shaw presented applying here in the California coastal zone?
Yeah, I can start, Megan, if that's okay. So I see, there's lots of different tools in the toolkit for nature-based adaptation, right? And multipurpose reefs and cobble berms or dynamic revetments are definitely two tools in the toolkit. And cobble berms in particular, we've seen lots of our sort of, more famous nature-based adaptation projects. So places like Surfers Point and Ventura or Cardiff down in Encinitas, the Living Shoreline there, both of those actually use cobble in the designs. And so that cobble has been something that cobble is a very popular material that we find in California beaches. And so in places where it's, naturally occurring, and it's sort of nature in that environment is telling us, hey, maybe there should be some cobble in your design. I think it's a really good opportunity. And, Shai, really appreciated working through all those implementations of multipurpose reefs, and in particular, you know, the lessons that we've learned from implementing those all over the world. So I think lots to think about for California.
Yeah, I'll jump in quickly. I know there's so many questions to get through, but again, like Jeremy said, I've learned so much from the technical aspects that you guys were talking about. I'm sort of thinking more about the less technical aspects of how do these projects get generated and actually put in on the ground. One of the things that our agency has really tried to focus on is just doing more pilot projects in California, because we really need to continue to collect more data about the benefits of the nature-based solutions. We tend to focus on what are the impacts, but we need to continue to build more examples of the benefits for our shorelines and the multiple benefits, like both George and Shaw had talked about. I think in order, and both speakers talked about projects being driven by community, local communities. I think in order to do that, we, the state, we really need to put some resources into these kinds of projects. We need to fund them, and we need to provide technical assistance and permitting assistance to any of the cities or the organizations that are willing to kind of step up and take on these kinds of projects, and the one, like the ones that Justin mentioned, I think that we do need more examples of projects in high energy environments. We just don't have enough of those kinds of project examples. And then I was just really curious about, it seems like maybe the sort of pathways for approvals might be different in Washington and New Zealand and Australia than they are in California. And I was just thinking, I wonder how these projects sort of made it through, like how they were approved and reviewed by the regulatory agencies and the local agencies in those places as well. But those are my thoughts, and I'm sure that the rest of my colleagues in the other agencies have similar thoughts and great questions. So thanks so much for putting this on, though. I appreciate it.
Thank you, Megan. I think that's a really great question we can start off with. So George and Shaw, just so you know, oftentimes these pilot projects too can be really helpful in getting past the permitting process. If it's a pilot, you know, sometimes you can get your short-term permits. Some of these other projects can be really hard to permit in our California coast. So if you could speak to Megan's question kind of about the regulatory side of how do your nature-based solutions get permitted? What's your process like? How hard or easy is that? And what does that tend to look like for you all?
Shall I go first there, Georgie? Okay. Look, I have had a bit of experience with and how things were being done with Ventura. So I have some familiarity how it was being done in California. The main for things we're looking at is it's impact based. So what are the, you know, we're trying to the designs are trying to have a positive impact on encouraging that the beach is going to get wider, and the main way we're showing that is both through wherever your site is, looking and identifying how you've got natural structures that are doing this already. And then through the tools like the numerical models and the empirical formulas, similarly going in and seeing what the ecology is at these sites and doing comparative surveys at stable sites, so where there's reef material close by. I guess it's probably 10, 11 years ago since we last visited, even longer, last visited oil piers there in Ventura. I recall the biggest thing of concern environmentally. I mean, there was things about, you know, how much, some things I didn't understand about your CO2 emissions while you're constructing. And there's a 14 lane freeway right beside your site. I didn't understand where that fitted in. But you guys will know, is it the grunion fish? That was the biggest issue, and it came down to making sure that you're constructing at the right time of year, that you're not going to interfere with their breeding and spawning. But really, in comparison to more developmental projects, putting in new marinas and or seawalls for ports or extractive like seabed mining and that kind of stuff, far easier than any other way. And especially with the, and I threw it in that last slide, getting the buy-in from the community, and it's not just the buy-in, their full involvement and ownership. They know what's important to them and they know what they want to see in the future, and you get that partnership to really develop what is possible for your sites as well. It's really easy. Well, I'd like to have this happening here, but if it can't be done within your coastal process, you can't do it. But I think that has been a time and time again, getting the stakeholders involved from day one.
Thank you, Shaw. George, did you want to talk a little bit about your regulatory structure for this?
Yeah, sure. This started to sort of ease the regulatory side of things with the North Cove approach. And as I mentioned, North Cove has seen such massive amount of erosion that there was actually huge problem with houses falling onto the beach and just, septic tanks. It was just a horrible situation and not good policies and funding mechanisms to clean up the beach with all the damage that was causing. So it was sort of like with North Cove sort of kicking this approach off, it was like, we can do no harm by trying to stabilize the North Cove beach because, we just looked at it from many different angles. The status quo of the destruction that was going on and the impacts to the beach environment was so great that, certainly taking a nature-based approach made just a lot of sense to everybody. So it sort of, that started with sort of easing the regulatory approach where like, we can't do any harm here. We're getting a lot of impacts as it is. And then we saw so much success with it in terms of stabilizing the beach, creating a nice beach environment. People are out enjoying it. It's even to the point now that the razor clams are coming back because it's more stable environment for shellfish. There's all the sort of habitat benefits happening. So that I think went a long way because the idea of putting rock along the shoreline and doing any kind of harsh stabilization is not encouraged, it's highly discouraged. But on the other hand, with cobble and it being mimicking nature and having cobble berms on other parts of our shoreline, part of it when it comes down to like the state shoreline management guidance, we're trying to preserve the natural character of the shoreline. And the North Cove example really demonstrated how there's actually an enhancement of that natural shoreline. And yes, we're putting in cobble along basically a dune-backed environment, although there were no dunes left at North Cove, sort of changing the environment from completely sand and dune-based to introducing cobble that's not there naturally. However, again, like even in the summer months, much of the cobble is covered in sand. There's so much accretion, and we're sort of blessed with beaches that, although they have, in cases like this, have high erosion, there's a lot of sand supply. And so drifting sand and from aeolian transport and just taking out the reflected energy during the winter months when the water levels are higher and waves are higher, and creating a more depositional environment to build up sand. We actually found that the beaches, like I mentioned, on the west side of this project area, were actually accreting where they had never accreted before, in any sense, more than just on sort of an annual scale as a fluke. Now we have an accretion that's been going on for 5 years. And so part of it was just the process of the regulatory agencies seeing the success and not seeing the impacts, but actually seeing environmental benefits. So that went a long way, I think, toward acceptance of the approach. There's ongoing communications among the agencies, the regulatory agencies, on how to kind of see this forward, because there is a growing interest due to the success. And, there's active communications about this, but in general, what we're seeing is that we're kind of restabilizing and providing some natural beach benefits that would otherwise not be realized, given alternatives of hard solutions and retreat being really difficult politically and from a policy standpoint.
Thank you. Thanks, everyone. Okay, so we had a question come in. How do these perform under sea level rise scenarios? Do they need to be raised over time? What needs to be done to make sure that they can continue to be successful under sea level rise? George and Shaw, would you like to speak to kind of both of the practices that you you touched on and how sea level rise may or may not impact?
I'll just quickly, since I didn't mute myself yet, mention that the example that I showed at Shoalwater, where there's a massive amount of material and you see that ridge developing of, it's almost like a couple meters high ridge on a face that has a lot of material. Basically, that's what happens under high water levels. So we've seen that where the cobble moves upslope and can create a ridge that basically does not get overtopped. So that's possible with the right conditions and the right environment where the cobble can actually go move uphill and keep up with sea level rise, what we're seeing on sort of that short-term scale. And it's also been borne out in a lab experiment recently on the world's largest lab flume in Germany with some colleagues from the UK that showed that they could not get the cobble berm to be overtopped under what they were simulating as sea level rise conditions. So it has its benefit. It's not to say they would never be overtopped during a storm or sea level rise. It does require a place for the cobble to move landward and upward and the right sort of inherent geography and geometry to do that. But under some situations, it can certainly be a solution for sea level rise that it can keep up and adapt to sea level rise.
I guess from personal experience too, in a project here in Raglan, so Raglan Headland, which I showed you, stretches over 4 kilometers and is all cobble, andesitic cobbles. There was a house to be built in, and it has been built a while back now, in the lagoon area, and concerns about impacts of sea level rise. We actually had a 1 in 1200 year storm event, and it did just that. It grew the cobble berm along in front of indicators, threw the cobble up there, and continued to grow the height of the cobble berm, so it provided further and future coastal protection. When we come to the MPRs, I think using the traditional construction with rocks, it's a lot easier they will have to keep on moving up the crest. And I guess there's two aspects of that. And we looked at that sensitivity testing of how far you move it up. And I think in all projects, and George presented, and I didn't present much at all of, is monitoring. On the coast now, it's forever changing, not only the sea level rising, but climate change is changing, weather patterns, cyclone intensity, where they're moving. We need to monitor and adaptively manage. So we don't have, we're working away from having time triggers. They're great ways of kind of setting some goalposts and things, but we don't really know, as we get to 50 years and 100 years out, how things are going to change in terms of the sea level rise and how their impact on particular sites. So that monitoring and adaptive management is really important to set those trigger levels and do your maintenance or adding more to your structures. Thanks.
Thank you, Shaw. Okay, I'm going to ask one last question from the chat, and then I'm going to actually turn it to Jeremy and Megan to see if they have any final questions for Shaw and George that, would help their California colleagues and thinking about how everything we've heard today, its application to California. So the last question from the chat is, how did you get these projects funded? Who paid for these? And what tips do you have in terms of funding these projects?
Yes, I'll go first there again. Look, a large difference across the board with what they're about. Although one of the biggest things that has driven them for the coastal protection and the beaches has been the value of the beach amenity. And you saw there, Gold Coast now has two of these kind of structures in. The Gold Coast City Council, it's all about the beaches. It's tourism, and it's getting the dollar value of the beaches very recognised. When they have erosion events, they've linked that to downturns in their tourism. When it's been all over the news that a cyclone has come through and removed their beaches, it impacts on their tourism. And they're pointing back to some of that work from Houston, from the US Army Corps. A lot of it, you know, even that was a lot of the groin work back in the day in Florida. It was all about being driven by the tourism kind of approach. But other ones are more about the erosion and property, private and local government infrastructure, that kind of thing. So a big range. I know the Australian ones different right now. West Australia, they've put millions into increasing coastal resilience. So there's pots out there that you can dip into. A lot of our Pacific Island work, again, looking at nature-based solutions, and that comes from large organisations and large funds. Was it the Green Climate Fund and the UNDP, ADB, those kind of funding agencies?
Thank you. And George?
Yeah, so in Washington, some of this was actually started by the community, like at Westport. They brought together the monies that they had. And then with the approach that looks promising, we got some money from basically a state conservation commission that went through a local conservation district to fund the initial construction of the project, and then some maintenance. And then from there, North Cove is still struggling to get the proper amount of support, but we are supporting, asking for that with a variety of the coastal resilience funding coming from the federal level now. And then Westport was completely funded by the homeowners themselves. They have been doing a variety of nature-based approaches in advance of this, and decided to fund this themselves as a homeowners association community. In the case of Shoalwater, it was federally funded. As I mentioned, Graveyard Spit, one that's coming online next year, is a variety of state transportation dollars, but we've been able to get some NIFWIF funding to do the design work, and now three different kind of two federal and one state source of funding to actually construct the project. So it's a variety of mechanisms. Primarily, we're looking at the variety of coastal resilience funding at the state and federal level that can feed into these kind of projects.
Thank you. All right, Jeremy, Megan, do you all have anything you want to ask the speakers to bring it back to California that you think your colleagues would really benefit from?
I had a few sort of comments / questions. One on the multipurpose reefs. It was sort of interesting when you mentioned, Shaw, that, you know, in terms of how these engineered structures impact, you know, the transport of sand, how they really differ from groins, and that a groin is something that's typically stopping all the sand until it's full and then it bypasses, whereas a multipurpose reef is more slowing the movement in an area. And I just wondered if you could quickly speak to like how is it different than a groin in terms of the movement of sand and impacting downcoast beaches?
Yeah, sure. Yeah, I guess there's two parts to that. When you are widening the beach, you know, normally we would recommend that renourishment goes in, because you've worked out through your modeling and etc. what your response would be. But we have seen that you know, what once you've widened the beach, you hit a static equilibrium. A dynamic equilibrium, not static, where you don't want that tombolo effect, where your salient comes out and joins onto your structure. But and with that gap between, you can still get sand moving backwards and forwards. And especially in your normal everyday kind of wave climate, it can. When you've got something hard like that on the beach, like the groin, it really is, yeah, it's black and white. It just stops things. So they're much more subtler kind of approach. And you're not trying to stop things. You're just trying to modify the environment by, that bit of wave attenuation, creating those better current circulation patterns, trying to get all those factors together rather than, and that was one of the big, and right now, I know I flew through a lot of slides, but what we've seen now from the monitoring where these have been applied, you don't get that up coast, or down coast, coastal erosion because you're capturing the sand. And that is still not fully understood by a lot of coastal engineers. They believe that sand's got to come from somewhere. And actually where we do find some of that sand comes from is you get an offshore kind of groin effect, so that on your downside of your offshore structure, you get a slight lowering of the seabed, but it's subtle enough not to really have any negative impacts.
Thanks. And, you know, I definitely have way more questions, but I'm going to pause in case Megan has any.
I mean, I have a lot of thoughts. First, I just wanted to say thank you for introducing managed advance into my lexicon. Hadn't used that before, and I like it. And also want to say, Jeremy and I have already been chatting about places that we'd like to try some of these different approaches in California, and particularly thinking about where might be some locations where the beach is already so narrow and so constrained by infrastructure that we really don't even have the width that we would need to implement a nature-based solution on the shoreline. So using a multi-purpose reef in the proper location might, combined with shoreline features, can really help us build that beach. And I just wanted to throw that out there to all of our agencies on the phone as something that is a really interesting idea that I personally don't know about many pilot projects or projects that have done that in California. So let's maybe think about some places where that might be an appropriate solution. Other than that, I don't have questions. I just want to thank you again for the presentation.
Thank you. Okay, we're running short on time. Unfortunately, we're not going to get to, I think, our resources portion, but we will make sure to send the resources to you all after when we're sending the presentation as well. Mary, would you mind running that last poll? And I'm going to pass it to Lauren now to close us out.
Thanks, Melis, and thank you all so much for sharing your expertise. So we have a polling question about kind of these further learning opportunities. So would folks be interested in further learning opportunities on this topic and learning exchanges across the agencies that were here today? Please let us know. And then we also have a survey that I'll see if Melis can put in the chat. So if you want to kind of elaborate on what types of learning opportunities or topics. I think we saw one in the chat about low wave energy shorelines and maybe doing something similar on that topic. So if you have any specific topics, please elaborate on those in the survey or evaluation link that Melis is going to put in the chat. That helps us kind of know how to design these programs and allows us to continue the programs. But yes, we are running a little bit short on time. So we have a resources section on resources from NOAA's Digital Coast that can help support implementation of these solutions. So some of these resources are around effectiveness. So different studies and literature on the effectiveness of these practices. I think someone mentioned that in the chat earlier, the Green Infrastructure Effectiveness Database. So that's one of them that we'll send out. Also, we have a few quick references on the different practices you can implement and the benefits and some of the how to do some economic assessment of those practices. We also have quick references on funding and financing. So we got a little bit into that in the panel. So these quick references, and then we have associated webinars. They are on our Digital Coast as well. So we'll send those out. So if you're interested in kind of exploring environmental impact bonds or stormwater credit trading or revolving loan funds and kind of some of those other creative financing strategies. We have information on those topics. And then we also have in-person training. So we'll send out information about that as well. So it dives a bit deeper than a virtual webinar. And we spend about 8 hours together, really talking through project ideas and design and maintenance and partners and funding and all those good things and kind of leave with a green infrastructure strategy. So we'll send out kind of the slides on those different resources so you can check those out. And then Melis and I are here, of course, as resources for you if you have questions or want us to kind of do a presentation at some point just around resources. We're happy to do that as well, in addition to covering kind of some of these other topics that you might be interested in. So thanks for doing the poll and thank you for responding to the survey. And I know there were a lot of questions in the chat that we didn't get to. So I think what we'll do is we will record those questions and get them to our speakers. George and Shaw, would you be willing to answer some of these questions that were in the chat that we didn't get to? And then we could send those out via email to folks so that they have responses. Does that work for y'all?
Sure, no problem.
Yeah, that works for me, thanks.
Awesome, thank you so much. Yes, there were some good detailed questions in there that we wanna make sure people get responses for. So I think with that, I'm just curious if folks could quickly share in the chat one thing they plan on doing after today, based on what you learned, one kind of action or next step you plan to take, whether it's sharing information with your colleagues or reaching out to George and Shaw or checking out the Digital Coast resources. Just curious, want to make sure that we do something with this information. Cody's going to visit the beach. Perfect. Maybe visit some of the, you know, some of the sites that we heard about today. Check out the resources provided. Thinking about shoreline protection as dynamic. Yep. Awesome, Jen. Checking out the Digital Coast resources, Todd. Perfect. Learning more about cobble berm use in different settings. Think about more pilot projects. Awesome. Thank you all so much for sharing. And yes, we will get those resources out to you and just really appreciate everyone's time. And thank you to all the agencies for organizing this and inviting your staff. And a big thank you again to George and Shaw for sharing your expertise and Megan and Jeremy for providing some reflection for the California Coastal Zone. We really appreciate it. So thank